Hello, welcome to the third episode of CCR Liberty in Detail. In the last episode, we were covering the individual parts of the units. And in this episode, we will be talking about the head and its components. This is going to be quite a comprehensive episode. We will cover the head in detail, we'll uncover most of its functions, and as you will see, the head is quite a piece of engineering. There will be lots covered in this episode, and if you would like to get back, we have put a description of the timeline into the video. So I hope you'll enjoy it. The head houses all the electronics that operate the rebreather and is made out of Delrin as well as the scrubber body. And the head, as you know from the previous episodes, can be used in all the configurations that we provide. Divesoft develops and programs its own electronics, its controls and the user interface. This allows us to have the unit exactly based on our philosophy and allows us to make changes, improve the system, or do anything that we would like based on our preference or the needs of our divers. As you will see, this gives us quite a lot of freedom. And as I will be going through the unit's features, you'll be able to see the uniqueness of the platform and its functions. The Liberty has four ways of displaying an information to you. It starts with our body display. This either glows red or it glows green. It sits behind your back and it's quite visible to your body in a back-mounted configuration. The next thing that shows you your information is your head-up display. This either glows red, blue, or green. And it shows you your information about the partial pressure of oxygen, and it also shows you your other information in a standby mode, such as charging or when you turn the unit on, and so on. The other feature that the head-up display offers is a colorblind mode, which can be used for divers that are having trouble seeing certain colors. If in certain conditions you find your head-up display being too bright, you can dim the LEDs by turning this shade down. That dims the brightness of your head-up display. Every unit comes with two handsets, which display all the necessary information and the results of both the control units. Each handset is powered through its corresponding control unit. The unit is operated with the handsets, however the handsets don't have any computing capability. The control units are safely placed inside of the head. The handsets vibrate as well as the phone in your pocket when you receive a message. Anytime there is anything important you need to know, the handsets will vibrate and let you know about it. The vibration is so strong that you can even feel it through a very thick undergarment of your trisuit. This could be information such as end of no deco time, excluded cell, or anything that you need to know about. The handsets have other functions as well. Apart from the vibration, they also have a thermometer that measures the ambient water temperature, and they also have a light sensor. What the light sensor does is that if you decide to dim your screen and you shine your light back at it, the screen will turn back on. The handsets also have accelerometer and inclinometer in them, which can be used to measure your angle of descent or ascent, or it can be used for mapping a cave or for other applications where you may find this useful. Handsets or any of these parts can be detached by using 3mm Allen key. Underneath here, we have wet connectors. So even if you flood the connector, it will have no effect on the function of the unit. So even if the handset or the handset cable gets damaged on the boat or in the wreck or in the cave, it will have no effect on function of the unit. Even if you lose both the handsets, our control units are still inside of the head, so it still has no effect on function of the unit. You will still be able to read your partial pressure of oxygen from your head-up display, and the unit will maintain your set point. If you do end up damaging the handset or the handset cable and you still wish to go diving, the great advantage is that you just disconnect the part, send it to us or to one of our service technicians for a service. And you can use this blind plug to plug the connector and keep diving. The control units, the brains of the unit, are located in a two individually sealed compartments, and they're all pressure tested to 350 meters. So they're nicely sealed off from the outer environment. The control units communicate with each other at all times through our oxygen cell block, which is located here. The block is sealed off and can also be removed by using 3 millimeter Allen key. When the unit is worn on the back, the block of the oxygen sensors sits on top, which reduces the amount of condensation getting onto the oxygen cells. Each control unit has two oxygen cells for itself, and you have access to all four cells at all times. The oxygen cells are on the inhalation side of the loop. In case of the control unit failure or the battery failure, this means that we would lose a half of our unit. However, all the systems within the unit are redundant. So by losing half, you still having all the crucial systems that you need for operation of the unit. So you'd still have two oxygen cells, you'd have a block of your pressure sensors, you'd have your battery powering all that, you would have your helium sensor, and you would still have your solenoid. The unit uses Molex type cells, and the voting logic works as such. The unit would take one cell and compare it with the other three cells. Then it would take the other cell, compare it with the other three cells, and it would keep on repeating this process all the way throughout your dive. If during your dive, a cell is excluded, you get a vibration alarm and the message on your handset that one of your cells got excluded. If the cell is just slow or is just lagging with its reading and returns back to the calculation, the unit automatically returns the cell back into the reading. If the cell, however, stays away from the reading of the other cells, it stays excluded. If you do not do anything about it, the unit will give you a reminder after some time, again, by a vibration, telling you check your cells. Also, next to your partial pressure of oxygen, you will have a little exclamation mark showing you every time you look at your partial pressure of oxygen about that you need to be more vigilant. You can manually vote the cells out and also vote them back in. As you can see, all the elements in the head are doubled. So we have a block of our oxygen cells, two for each control unit and each half. We have two blocks of pressure sensors. We have a pair of batteries. We have a helium sensor for each side as well. And we also have a pair of solenoids, also each one for its own side. Over here, we have our lithium ion batteries. Each one is powering its own half of the head. Those batteries are charged with USB cable, and you can use your phone charger to charge them as well, or you can use a power bank if you're out on an expedition or out in a field and you need to charge your batteries. The batteries can also be removed. Again, by using your 3 millimeter Allen key, you can just easily take the battery out and replace it with another battery if you carry spares for longer dives or for expedition type of diving. In case that any of these components would stop working, you can just easily take them out and replace them with a spare part. Wherever you can find 3 millimeter Allen key, that's the part that is serviceable by yourself and that can be taken out by you. All the components in the head have sealed connectors and are pressure resistant. If there was a discharge of gas in case of a battery malfunction, it would be discharged through this one-way valve out into the environment and not inside into the breathing mixture. When the unit's off, you would store your jumpers in the batteries this way. Now the unit's completely off. When you want to power the unit on, you just basically slide them out, slide them back in that way, and you will see it will start the unit up. Next step, moving to the solenoids. The solenoids are electromagnetic valves, which by activating, add the oxygen into our breathing mixture. Again, we have two solenoids, which alternate when firing in 6-second intervals. In the case of one of the solenoids would stop working, you have another one which would always take you back home. Those are magnetic solenoids which stay in a closed position until they have to fire. This increases the chance that in the case of solenoid malfunctioning, there is a higher likelihood that the solenoid would stay shut. You can manually turn the solenoids off in your user menu, as well as you can vote out other components such as helium sensors, oxygen cells, and your pressure sensors. We will look into this in more detail in our episode where we'll be talking about the menu controls. One very important feature that I would like to talk to you about is predictive algorithm. When the unit fires the oxygen, or the solenoid fires the oxygen, it isn't just open and close. What the unit actually does is that it calculates how long the solenoid needs to be open for based on your current partial pressure of oxygen, your set point, and your depth. This helps quite a lot in terms of controlling the unit and makes the diving a lot more precise when the unit is just giving you enough oxygen to what you need. Now we're going to look at our pressure sensors. To be easier for us to see them, I'm going to remove the oxygen cell block. I've taken the screws out by using the 3mm Allen key, and I'm just going to grab the cell block, pull it straight out, and here you can actually see how the control units communicate with each other. Okay, so I'm going to place the block here, and here we can see our two blocks of our pressure sensors. Each block contains two pressure sensors. One sensitive pressure sensor, which measures precisely your depth down to 10 meters, and it also measures the altitude that you dive in to adjust for your decompression algorithms. And another pressure sensor, which measures depth down to about 300 meters. A huge advantage of us having our pressure sensors inside of the head is that we know the exact pressure that's within our loop, up to a tenth of a millibar. This actually tremendously helps us during our pre-dive check. So we can, during our positive and negative pressure check, we can within 60 seconds work out whether we've got a loss of any gas within the loop. And we can that way very easily figure out whether our loop is properly sealed and whether we can enter the water or not. In case the unit would not pass the pre-dive check, we would go back and start tracking back down where the unit, where the leak is coming from. We will go through this procedure in our later episode about pre-dive sequence. The other advantage of having pressure sensors inside of the head helps us to figure out whether we have an overpressure or a vacuum within the loop, which is actually a very helpful feature to have when the unit is used as a bailout rebreather. But again, we're going to have a look at this later in our episode about bailout mode of the units. Next, moving on to our helium sensors. These matchbox size boxes are our helium sensors, each one for each side. The helium sensors work as a redundant part of the system. The way they actually work is the same as our standard analyzer, and the technology is exactly the same. In the system, the way they operate is that by knowing our nitrogen content, which we know prior to our dive by analyzing our gas, at depth, we can, given we're on trimix, analyze our helium content. Therefore, by knowing our nitrogen content, we can calculate our partial pressure of oxygen. This information would be quite crucial to us in case that for some reason we would end up losing all our oxygen cells. This is another way of redundancy of the system, which would allow us to get back home on the unit safely. The sensors run as passive units in the unit. They do their measuring, but they do not interfere to other run of the unit. So when you need to, you switch to your helium sensors and you get the readings out of them. As the technology is the same as in our analyzers, but just packed in a smaller package, we need a higher helium content of our breathing mixture to get an accurate measurement out of the helium sensors. Therefore, for this reason, we recommend using the helium sensors with a helium content of 30% and above. This also allows us to use a head as a trimix analyzer, and we also have a separate video about this. The oxygen feed to the solenoids is located here. For side mount divers that run the unit in a side mount configuration and wish to have the O2 feed a little bit more tacked away, we also offer an axial O2 feed, which can be exchanged by the diver, and just by simply removing this feed and screwing the new feed in here. This can also be ordered through the configurator. When it comes to the head accessories, there's again quite a few variety that you can choose from. We'll be looking more into the detail of those in our episode about all the available accessories. But also one more thing that I wanted to mention and that we will be looking into more depth later is that the head can also be used as an oxygen cell tester. Basically what it is you get a lid that screws that basically seals up the head, connect an oxygen to it, and you pressurize the head up to a 3.5 bar, and you'll be able to see the linearity of each individual cell to be able to detect if your cells are still good to be used. But we're gonna have a look more into the detail of this later. As we travel with our units quite often by a plane, we often get into a situation where we would carry our head, which is the most expensive and the crucial part of the equipment, with us in our onboard luggage. And sometimes when we go through the security check at the airport, the security personnel very often wonder, what is this thing that it's full of electronics and batteries and all other kinds of equipment that they sometimes don't know about. So we decided to come up with these brochures that you can use while you're traveling to provide the security personnel at the airport with the basic information about what the head is and where it belongs and what it contains. So every unit comes with a guide like this, which contains all the information about description about what the rebreather is, each description of each individual part, and so on and so forth. You can have it along with your passport handy. In case you already own a Liberty and you don't have one, or you have lost yours, we have another one which is easy to be printed. It's all available on our webpage. So that's it for the third episode. I hope you found it informative and that it helped you to answer some of the questions that you may have had. In our next episode, we will be talking about BOV and DSV options of our units. For more information, please visit our webpage at divesoft.com, where you can find our configurator, where you can have a play and configure the unit of your desired configuration. And you can also find more additional information there. Please don't forget to follow us at our social media, on our YouTube channel and our Facebook page. And if you have any further questions, please email us at info@divesoft.com. Thanks for watching, and I look forward to seeing you next time.